So, somebody asks, how do these fit in the same category? So let's just clarify what's going on here. The objects that we're working with in this category are sets. And that means that when we define what the arrows are, S and T are sets. But an arrow is not one of our regular functions from S to T. It's a funny function that takes an S and only maybe gives you a T. So instead of working with sets and functions, we're working with sets and flaky functions that might go wrong. But we should still be able to make the bits and pieces. Let's just have a recap. We said that the identity arrow, what did we have to manufacture? I should make this font bigger, shouldn't I? I can make that font slightly smaller, I think. We have to manufacture a flaky function from that goes from t to maybe t, and we decided that we would stick in yes, the function that actually isn't flaky, that always works. And then we were trying to figure out what goes here. I'll do it again. So we're trying, we've got a flaky function from that goes r to maybe s, and another flaky function that goes from s to maybe t. And we're trying to make a flaky function that goes all the way from r to maybe t. And we just got cracking, like, you know, we've got some pipes, we've got composition of ordinary functions, that's our solter. And we're ready to start plumbing. We know we can start from r, so let's start from r and go somewhere. Just do that ordinary function composition. Okay, so now we have to get from maybe S to maybe T. We've got a function that will start from S. So if we use the map operator for maybe, let's just check that we've got that handy. Yes. What happened there? Yes. So locally, with the modules I've opened, the functor we're working with is the maybe functor. So we've got a map operator that lifts functions from S to T to functions from maybe S to maybe T. So if we plug in G here, we'll end up needing to get from maybe T down to maybe T. That's to say, we've got two layers of maybe because we've worked in two stages. It could have gone, the outer maybe tells us whether the first stage went wrong, that's the F. The second stage tells us whether the G went wrong. So we've got two layers of maybe, and then we figured out we better write this join maybe operation that collapses the two layers of possible failure down to one, telling us did the whole thing go wrong at any point. So we plumb in join maybe, and we've built our notion of composition. Okay. But it's one thing to say we have something that's the right type to be composition. Better check that we really have a category. That's to say, we think we know how to plug these flaky functions together, but we better make sure that plugging on the identity operation doesn't make any difference. And that it's associative, that it doesn't really matter when we've got a sequence of these flaky operations, that it doesn't matter which order we pair them up in. just the sequence is important. So let's see what we have to prove. So this says, if we've got a function, then if we start by succeeding, and then try doing f, we know that try is going to work, and then flatten, we'll just get back the same thing as f. So if I have a proper look at that, it's asking us to prove that for any function f, so it's actually done all of the computation, that the yes got eaten by the join in exactly this way. We're left just proving that lambda x f of x is the same thing as f. And fortunately for us, it is. I could just have written ref there. Everybody happy with that? Okay. For the next law, if I normalize the goal, you'll see that what's going to happen is we start by doing f of x, and then if that works, we do yes to the answer. So the yes is the second thing in the chain now. And we have to show that that gives us the same behavior as f. REFL's not going to work this time because this is not exactly the same implementation. So here we have to use extensionality. That's to say, these functions aren't implemented the same way, but hopefully they do the same job. So maybe, yeah?
Is that just the same as the last one, kind of the opposite way around?
Yes. So in the first one, the yes came first and the F came afterwards. In this one, the F comes first and the yes happens afterwards.
Could we also use that sim function that you gave us to switch it around?
Well, that would swap the equality around,
But
it wouldn't change the order of the yes and the f. It just means that the equation that we had to prove was the other way around. So no, the right. So here we're trying to prove two functions are equal, and REFL won't do it. Because although we hope they do the same thing, they're implemented differently. So we need to use extensionality. So you always write extensionality, and then we've got a lambda. Okay. Yeah?
So, do you mind, I know you've already explained extensionality, but do you mind clarifying that when we should use extensionality?
Okay. Here's what happens. If you're asked to prove that two functions are equal, you can try doing it with REFL, and that will work if the two functions have the same implementation. So something just as simple as lambda x f of x counts as the same thing as f, as far as Agda is concerned. But something, maybe, something that does some extra pattern matching, even if it's not necessary pattern matching, won't look like the same implementation. Okay? So that's when you use extensionality. That's the method of proving two functions are equal by showing that if you feed in the same input, you get the same output. Okay? So now we've got our input x, and we have to prove a fact about x.
You could just always use extensionality, couldn't you?
Yes, you could. You could always use extensionality. So what we now have to prove is this fact. And as ever, we need to play the game of thinking, why is this stuck? Well, join maybe is stuck because its argument is stuck. And maybe is stuck because this thing is stuck. So we're going to need to get this thing out of the way somehow. We're not going to be able to do this easily in this place here. We're going to need a helper function. So let's get a helper function. What I do is I type help. Control C, Control H tells me the type of a thing. If help had this type, it would go in that hole. Okay, so what I do is I give myself a where clause and I copy and paste that handy type signature, and later I'll get rid of the Unicode. Maybe I want it to be a little bit more explicit. I'll do that again. I'm allowed to give it some hints about how I would like the helper function to work. So I'll say here, help f x. And if I say control C, control H, it gives me a type for help that will fit with that. So if help has this type, that will go in the hole. Now, pick it up, copy it into place. Help f x equals question mark. And now I'm ready to write my helper function. I'm just going to check that my helper function is fit for purpose by sticking it in the hole already. Okay, so that's a move where we need to do some more pattern matching, and we need to do pattern matching on something that isn't just a pattern variable. So we need to be writing a program, because then we can use with.
Could we not use with after, just up there, with after the...
No, with is not available inside Lambda. Even in fancy pattern matching Lambda, there's no with available. So you need to build a helper function at that point. So that gadget where you wish for a helper function by writing how you would use it, and then you say, tell me what type the helper function has to have to be used this way, is very handy indeed. Okay. So now we're writing a pattern matching program, and we're allowed to use with, and that's just as well. Because remember, this is stuck, because f of x is stuck. We want a pattern match on this stuck thing. So let's get f of x out of the way. We say with f of x dot 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 vertical bar, pick any old name. And now what's happened? We've got an extra variable that stands for the result of the function, that stands for f of x, and all the f of x's in the goal have turned into z's. Now we can pattern match on z. And we get two cases. In this case, the no case, the whole thing is collapsed to a no on both sides, so we're happy. And in this case, introducing that extra constructor has allowed the join to compute. So we end up with another easy go. So do you see what happens there? If you're stuck on something, if computation is stuck because something isn't computing, one of the things you can do is use with to get it out of the way. This is going to keep happening. Okay?
So why does I cannot know that it's last pattern match on FFS?
Well, it's... I'm trying to figure out a good interpretation of that question. Yeah, so here, so in our original goal, the proof was stuck on f of x. That's the point at which pattern matching wasn't being fed constructor, so it couldn't compute. So, something that was clever about thinking about how to do proofs would be able to figure out that it needed to get f of x out of the way. But Agda is not going to synthesize that for us.
Could we have some maybe then?
So I don't think there's a good rewrite that, that sorts this out here. We don't have any laws for how many. We got some laws that happens when you use maybe with the identity function and with composition, but we don't have any good laws for what happens when we use maybe with yes. So we just have to figure it out. Okay. Let's see what happens for the other law. It's big and horrible. That's still big and horrible. But I can see how we're going to begin. We're definitely going to begin. Somebody's going to give us about this yes and this join. That's where I want to go.
How do you make a function that takes n number of maybes and x and y?
So you got a bunch of different things, and each of them might go wrong.
Yeah, what's a maybe? And just reduce it all down.
Right. So you've got like something that takes maybe x.
Yeah.
And gives you a maybe x.
Because you know you can't have that separate function for each number of maybes. So.
Generally, when we work with monads, we generally do the flattening aggressively, so it never grows to too big.
Right.
If you've got a maybe, then you can just keep doing join, and eventually it'll get down. To one. But you'll never get rid of the last one, because it can go wrong, and you can't magically make it go right. What do I need? I need to have a wee look in the file I've given you to go with exercise. Exercise 2. There's lots of stuff in this. So first of all, you will get to cheat very slightly with this. At some point, I'll show you what happens if we take that away. All sorts of bad stuff happens if we take that away. Life gets harder. I'm giving you extensionality so that you can prove that functions are equal. And occasionally, annoyingly, it's necessary. Let's play spot the difference. Here are two functions, and these two take an explicit argument. And this says how to prove that two explicit functions are equal. I'm also giving you a subtle variation that proves two functions are equal when the functions take implicit arguments. So just need to watch that one. That will come up at some stage. I had to do some fairly murderous things to derive the implicit version from the explicit version. I wouldn't expect you to do that. I've also given you an implicit version of the kind of equal dollar equal operator. So remember, equal dollar equal, you get two equal functions and two equal arguments, and that tells you get two equal results. Yeah? Well, here, I'm being slightly less generous, but we get two functions that take an implicit argument and a proof that they're equal, and then if you apply them to the same argument, you get the same result. So I just had to build that kit for you to make life slightly less of a pain. We've got our definition of category and an operation which I'll come back to later. And you've got the category of sets. You've got the definition of a functor. And I haven't given you the category of categories, but I have given you some of its equipment. So you can see here, for any category, you have the identity functor, and it just does the identity to the objects and the identity to map. Here's composition of functors. And I have to prove some laws to show how, I mean, the operations for composition, what does a composition of functors do to the objects? It just does the composition of what the two functors do to the objects. First, what F does to objects, then what G does to objects. What does it do to arrows? First, what F does to arrows, and then what G does to arrows. So it's just saying, do whatever F does, then do whatever G does. It's composition. Then I have to prove that everything comes out the same. So I better show you this. I built some equipment for writing proofs. It's sitting in the prelude. It looks like bizarre mixfix magic. But it's really just, you can see from the type, it's really just transitivity of equality. If x equals y and y equals z, then x equals z. So that's how you chain equality proofs together. And the thing that's funny is that the starting point, the x, is given explicitly. So what happens is, your starting point was here. The reason why you can make your first step goes here. And the reason why you make your next step goes there. So let's see that happen in practice. You can begin to read why this law makes sense, right? How do I show that composition of functors maps the identity to the identity? Well, I have to show that if we start with the identity in our source category C, and then we transform it by what F does to arrows, and then by what G does to arrows, out will come the identity. So I'm going to have to go in steps. So I use my operator for chaining proofs together, and in between the square bracket and the pointy bracket, I give the proof that I'm going to use for the first step. And that's going to say, well, hang on a minute, I know that F preserves identity, so I can at least turn this bit into the identity. And then I have to wrap map G around it. So that's my first step. And then afterwards, I have to give the explanation for the rest of the way. But I do it in the same style, which means I say where I've got to, and then how to keep going. So this is where we got to after doing this step. We got to this thing. And then I can use the identity law for G. And finally, I have to explain how to get from here to itself. And that's what the QED does. QED is the same as REFL, it looks nice when you finish a proof to say QED. So it's postfix. So this basically says, we start here, we do this to get here, then we do this to get here, and then we're done. And this way, you can actually see in the finished program what the steps of the proof were. Because what often happens at Magda is that you can see what you're trying to prove in the goal, and you do rewrite steps or whatever it happens to be. But you don't see, when you do a rewrite, you give the proof of the equation, but you don't see the equation. And then the goal changes, but the goal isn't in your program text, so you never actually record what happened. You tell it, the program records a bunch of moves, but you can't see what the moves are doing. So this is a style of doing an equational proof, which allows you to see the steps along the way. So here I've got the things that we're actually joining up with equations, and the reasons why we can turn one into the next. So that's a handy thing. And I have to do the same thing for composition. I start by saying, well, I've got to show that this composition of maps respects composition of arrows, but I know, first of all, that F respects composition of arrows, and that gets me to a composition of F-mapped things, and then I know that G respects composition of arrows, and that gets me all the way out. So, you know, I had to do that. That's fairly bureaucratic and boring. But, you know, that's how it's done. Right. So the key thing I'm trying to get to is this notion of a natural transformation. Because we just wrote two natural transformations. And what is a natural transformation? It's a kind of arrow. It goes between two functors. And what it says is that for all x, we can get from f of x to g of x. So I think you've written loads of these. Right. So they're polymorphic functions between container-like structures, if you like. So things like reversing a list, yeah? Reversing a list works for any element type. It takes lists in and it gives lists out, preserving the element type, and it works for all element types, yeah? And what naturality means is that if you've got an operation on elements, let's say, for example, we've got a list of numbers. We could use map to double all the numbers, and then we could reverse the list. Let's do it, right? We've got our list, 1, 2, 3. Now let's use a pen that works. Suppose we have the list, 1, 2, 3. We could first of all map the doubling operation across this. And what would we get? So map, double. What would we get? 2, 4, 6. And then we could reverse the list. What would we get? 6, 4, 2. Alternatively, we could reverse the input list. What would we get? 3, 2, 1. And then what happens if we map double across that? We get the same thing, 6, 4, 2. So that's what naturality means. We've got a polymorphic operation. That's to say, it works for any element type. How could it work for any element type? In order to work for any element type, it has to not care about the element type. It doesn't know about the element type. So it can't possibly do anything to the elements apart from move them around a bit. Correspondingly, if we've got a map operation which acts only on the elements, preserving the rest of the structure, it doesn't matter whether we do that. So that's like doubling here, right? We're doubling the elements, but we're preserving the structure of the list. So we know reverse only affects the structure of the list, not the elements. And we know map double only affects the elements, not the structure. So it doesn't matter which we do first. You know, either way, we manage both to do whatever happens to the structure with reverse and whatever happens to the elements with double. So any time you write a polymorphic function, you'll discover that it has a naturality property. Because the polymorphic function couldn't look at the element type, even if it wanted to, because you can't pattern match on types. So they can't help but be natural, which is lovely, except for the fact that Agde doesn't know that. So you still have to prove that it's natural. There's a paper, a great paper by Philip Wadler, called Theorems for Free, in which he explains why polymorphic functions always have that naturality property. So you just look at the type and you can read off what naturality property something has. When you see polymorphism, you know that there's some uniformity of behavior, and that's going to come out as a handy fact. So polymorphism always gives you something, right? To write a polymorphic function, you have to promise not to look at an element type. Otherwise, how can it be polymorphic? And when you promise not to look, you're guaranteeing something. And what you're guaranteeing is naturality. So yes, this paper, Theorems for Free, explains why you always have that. Annoyingly, in Agde, despite the fact that these theorems are supposed to be for free, you still have to prove them. Because Agde doesn't know. Agde hasn't learned Phil Wadler's lesson. And that's extraordinarily irritating. And there are plenty of people working on fixing that, so that one day we'll not have to do this nonsense. What I want to do, I better paste that definition into my lecture file. Let's go to. Okay. And now I want to just write yes is a natural transformation. I haven't got everything I need. I also need that stuff. See if we're lucky. So I want to write a natural transformation from the identity functor to the maybe functor. When you unpack that, let's see what it is. So we build a record. We got to give one function and one proof. But when we normalize it, it's a polymorphic function from the identity applied to x, taking us to maybe applied to x. Yes! And then what's the naturality property? Well, that one's easy. So what does it say? It says if you do the function to the element and then apply yes to the answer, that's the same as doing yes to the element and then mapping the function across it. But what will mapping a function across yes x do? It'll make yes f of x. So that's lambda f, f or something. The other thing that we had was join, and that is.
Right, is there any reason to make it a lambda rather than just putting naturality in there?
I could say naturality equals REFL there, sure. I think. Let's just see. Sometimes I write extra lambdas where they're not really necessary.
Don't think.
Let's see. Oh, what have I got? Not in scope. functor C. Right.
Yeah, doesn't it need to be an angle? That's the F equals reference.
Yeah, I have to write, so I have to write a lambda in order to get that.
Can you just put the F on the other side of the equals?
No. But I'll show you something, since you ask. There's another way to build records in Angular, which is worth knowing about. It's called co-pattern matching. So you know pattern matching splits data types up into constructor cases? Co-pattern matching builds records. So instead of splitting things up, it's building stuff. And instead of working on data types, it works on records. And it says, if you're trying to define a record, you can do it by defining the individual fields. And you do co-pattern matching by doing, by leaving the hole empty, and you do Control-C, Control-C, and it says, pattern variables to case, empty for split on result. So I hit, I leave it empty, I hit return, and I get two left-hand sides, one which says, what's the function for yes? And the other one is, what's naturality for yes? So here I can say, yes. And here, because I'm still pattern matching, I can write an F left of the equal sign. So that's kind of cool. It'll become more important later. So let's just get join and its naturality, and then some headline news. So let's do the same thing. We've got to write a function. What is the function? It's for maybe, maybe x to maybe x. I can, of course, because we've already defined join maybe, I can just type it in here. Or indeed, I could write MMX here and start pattern matching, because co-patterns and patterns play together nicely. So that's what we had before. And now I have to prove it's natural. What do I have to show? I have to show that if you've got two layers of maybe and you apply a function to the elements that are packed up inside those two layers, so that's why I've got to have two layers of the mapping operation, so that I get to the elements that are buried two levels deep. So if I act on the elements that are buried two levels deep and then I join the two levels together, that's the same thing as joining the two levels together and then just acting on the elements one level deep. So we either act on the elements when they're buried right inside and then merge, or we merge and then we act on them, and that should give us the same answer. So here I can write my F there, but annoyingly I'm going to have to, I can't do any more pattern matching. I'm going to have to use extensionality. And then I have to write a lambda. And what have I got? I've got my x is a maybe, maybe x, so I can put an extra set of curly braces around that and do some pattern matching on x now. We get that, which is easy. But then the fun starts, because the automatics don't like co-patterns. Now what's happening? Yeah, it looked like a good idea, but the termination checker is terrified of this way of writing it. I'm just going to have to build it as a record. That sometimes happens. I wish they'd sort that out. So it was complaining because the type, because the one field of the record was used in the type of the other one, and it was thinking, oh, that's some kind of funny loop. it's paranoid. So that was join maybe. Where did it go? Did I? You wrote it somewhere. I think it's just in a module. Just open maybe cap. And now I can do that. And now I need to do this lambda f arrow extensionality lambda mx arrow question mark. Pattern match on mmx. And we've got two cases. That one's easy. And this one will be even easier. So as I said, they can't help but be natural. So I need to do a little bit more on this next time. But here's the deal. I'm not going to show you the full works, and that's ugly and wide. But if you've got some functor M and you want to show that it is a monad, you need two pieces of equipment. You need a natural transformation from the identity to M. That says you can always make one M layer. That was what our yes was doing, was making one layer of maybe. And then there's another thing which is called multiplication, which says if you've got a composition of two M layers, you can always join them together to make one. So unit, if you like, is saying if you have a thing, you've got a plan to make a thing, a plan to get a thing. And mult is saying if you've got a plan to get a plan to get a thing, you've got a plan to get a thing. And then you have to prove three laws, which amount to saying if you do mult, but one of your layers is just the sort of trivial layer made by unit, that doesn't do anything. You get where you started from. And if you've got three layers, then what's this composition doing? Flattening the outer two, leaving you with two. Flattening the two remaining. What's this composition doing? It's flattening the inner two and then flattening the two remaining. So if you've got three layers and you're flattening them down to one, it doesn't matter whether you start in the middle and work out or start on the outside and work in. You get the same answer. And that was effectively what we were proving to show that our maybe arrows joined up. So whenever you have that structure, you have a category whose arrows